Eosinophilic Esophagitis. Eosinophilic Esophagitis. Hello guys, and welcome to today's video. Today's video was supposed to be done with Danielle. However, Danielle is really, really sick. But if you guys have any questions specific for Danielle, please leave it in the comments below. I'm going to kind of talk about Danielle's EoE condition. A lot of you guys probably know it as her choking condition because that's kind of what started us on the path of this. A lot of people ask, and it's so hard for me to explain in that like 10 second clip for me to just like word vomit at you on what's happened, what's going on kind of thing. Danielle is my now 15 year old daughter. When Danielle was about 9 or 10 years old, her little brother, Lonnie Jr., he had one of those Halloween Jolly Ranchers, the ones that were like rectangle stick ones kind of thing. Well, he got one stuck in his throat. I guess it went sideways down his throat. It got stuck. He was turning blue. He was vomiting. We had to call 911. It was a whole big thing. Danielle saw the whole thing and it really, really scared her. Fast forward about a year or two, Danielle suddenly just doesn't want to eat anything without water or something. She was always just so scared of choking. So I kind of thought it was just kind of like a bad experience for her. When I was little, I choked on a fishbone and after that I didn't want fish. So I thought it was kind of something like that from watching Lonnie Jr. almost choke. When Danielle was about 10 to 11, she got these white bumps all right here. I think they were there for about a year. They disappeared. So about a year later, she started to have some weird reactions to some foods, mainly like tree nuts and citrus fruits. She said that it felt like there was a lump in her throat, and then it also would make it where her throat would get really scratchy and red. She didn't say it felt like her throat was closing up. It just felt really itchy and that there was a lump there. So I didn't think anything of it. I was like, okay, well, I'll eventually take her to go get her allergy tested. After that, she always had to have something to swallow her food, always. I remember that specifically. Like, it doesn't matter what she was eating. She would not eat if she didn't have something to drink. So if we were in the car and we grabbed some fast food and I didn't have a soda with me, it didn't matter how hungry she was. She would wait till we got home. So I thought that was weird, but again, I thought it was linked to the Lonnie Jr. thing. I thought it was just kind of, I don't want to say all in her head, but I understand when something scary happens to us, sometimes we kind of internalize it more than we realize. Fast forward to her being 14. We were about to move down here to Clearwater and she had this choking incident. It was really, really scary. A lot of people think, oh, food got stuck. No, it was literally where she could not breathe. And so Lonnie kept doing the Heimlich, I don't even remember what specifically happened. All I remember is I had 911 on my phone. He was able to help her get enough out where her airway was free enough where she could at least breathe a little bit. But when she would breathe, like, you could hear that it was still in her throat. It was really, really crazy, really, really scary. We thought it was a weird incident. She said she chewed her food. I thought maybe she didn't. I mean, as a mom, kids say things, kids think things. I have 6 children. If I thought worst case every single time something happened with my kids, we would be living at the hospital or the doctor's office. So I was just like, weird incident, let's move on. Fast forward to 2 weeks later, just 2 weeks, we had just moved here. Suddenly, Noah is yelling, Danielle is choking. Thankfully, she had a Sprite by her. If you guys remember the video, Sprite saved my daughter's life, this is kind of in that video. And a lot of our regulars will already know a lot of this, so I'm sorry it's repeat, it's for new people. If you're here just for me to talk about the condition, I am going to get to it, I promise. I just wanna kinda tell Danielle's story a little bit so it makes sense when I'm explaining it. So, we rushed down. Danielle had Sprite. The carbonation from the Sprite helped her vomit enough up where, again, the airways was free and she was able to get up the rest about 5-10 minutes later. So the second time was less scary than the first time, but it was 2 weeks apart and Lonnie and I were like, this can't be normal. Like, this is no longer a coincidence. This is weird. So, gotta adjust my crown there. I decided to make her a pediatrician appointment. He told me some weird thing that he thought it was, although he did say EoE, but the way he explained it was wrong. So we went to go see the GI doctor. He agreed with the first pediatrician that he thought it was EoE or possibly EoE. He said the only way we will know is if we do an endoscopy and take a biopsy. Basically, they take a biopsy of her esophagus, her intestines, her stomach, and all of that. Then if there's enough of these EoE cells, that's how an EoE diagnosis happens. The results came back that they were higher. However, we saw the nurse practitioner for the results the first time. She didn't tell us that they were positive and that she had EoE. She basically said that she had H. pylori and that could be causing these results, and not to worry, it probably was an EoE and that Danielle could eat whatever she wanted to eat. When we saw the pediatrician, they had put her on a soft diet, so she wasn't allowed to have bread or any of that. And now we are still in the midst of like finding out Danielle's sugars and things like that, but when she went for her second endoscopy is when the nurse told me that she tested positive for EoE. So that's when I talked to the doctor, and the doctor was like, oh yeah, she definitely has EoE. Her biopsy results were worse the second time than the first time, so that is when we started to do the dairy and nut elimination diet. Now, the only nut she was having at that time was peanuts, because tree nuts make her have the like scratchy throat reaction. Tomorrow is her appointment. We will kind of find out what the results are. The scope did look better this time, but there was still white stuff on her esophagus that isn't supposed to be there. So we will kind of figure out what's going on. Eosinophilic esophagitis. Eosinophilic esophagitis. It is a very rare disease. It affects 1 in 200,000 individuals, and it usually comes on the onset of puberty. I always feel like I'm like explaining this wrong, but basically when you have EoE, certain triggers, whether it's environmental, whether it's food, allergies, whatever it is, causes the buildup of white cells. So that's why they do the biopsy, to kind of check to see what the white cell count is in specific areas. They can build up so much that you can physically see them. That's what the white stuff on the esophagus was. It can cause inflammation, thickening of the esophagus, and therefore it makes food a lot harder to go down. That's why she always had to have something to drink to wash it down, and that's also what made her choke, because her esophagus was smaller when it's inflamed. It is lifelong. Like, she's gonna have to deal with this the rest of her life. A lot of times they will prescribe antacids with it as well. Someone can have an EoE trigger like dairy and not necessarily be allergic to dairy. Someone who's allergic to dairy, it's usually digestive. Immediately when you have the dairy, it causes issues. With EoE, it's not specifically like that. A lot of people expect it to be immediate, because a lot of people have asked me like a week after she was dairy free how she's doing. Is she's doing better? That's why they do these biopsies. They are counting white blood cells, and that's also why I think it's ridiculous when people started to say that I just want something wrong and I'm just making this up, it's for attention, it's for views, when they literally do a biopsy. Like, it is literally medical. There's no way that I can make my daughter build up white blood cells in her esophagus. I am not that talented. And they will be doing an allergy test on her, because she also has some really weird reactions. Soy is the worst reaction she ever had. She said it was really scary. Like, she could literally feel her throat closing up. She can't have tree nuts and she can't have most fruits. So it makes it really hard when we're trying to put her on these limiting diets and she's already allergic to so much. It can also cause other problems as well. Like, Danielle will go through bouts where she has really bad stomach pain, and we really didn't know what it was from until like the doctor explained that is what it's from. It can even cause headaches. Like, it causes a lot of things that make sense to us now. It's hard because it's not like she's just gonna take antibiotics and it's just gonna disappear. We first have to kind of figure out what all of her triggers are. It's not easy. It's very drawn out. Like, this happened when we just moved here and we've been here for almost 7 months now. Everyone is different with this. Some people have food triggers. Some people have environmental triggers. Some people can take the medicine, like the antacids, and it'd be fine. I'm making this video because there isn't a lot of information about EoE. So I kind of want to bring some awareness to it. And I also want a video again that people can go to if they have questions. A question I know been asked if they're going to do an allergy test on her, and they eventually will. I think his priority right now is just to kind of find out her triggers. It does impact her school. After the holidays, I'm actually going to be getting her a 504 plan. It makes her sick some days. Like, she'll go through like weeks and weeks and weeks where she just feels sick all of the time. So when she has to do the endoscopy, the anesthesia makes her so out of it, she misses school that day. And then about a week and a half later, that we have to go all the way to the children's hospital to get the results. And when you're in high school, missing a day is a big deal. We will make a different video once Danielle's completely in remission and kind of talk about all of her triggers and what got her there. But this will kind of open up the segue for others to know that this does happen. And if you do have a child that is having similar issues like choking, having issues swallowing, always having to have something to swallow it down, I'm not saying it is EoE, but those are some big, big, big key signs for us that something else was going on. It kind of sucks Danielle couldn't be here because I know that she could kind of add more, and I'm just going based off of what she's told me. I think that is it. I hope I explained it correctly. Triggers cause too many EoE cells. Too many EoE cells cause choking and other issues. I could have probably made it a 5-second video saying that. If you have EoE or if your child does, please comment below. I am new. I want all the information. It's completely a new thing to me. I've never had a child that was so sensitive to things. Thank you guys for tuning into this video, and we will see you guys tomorrow.
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas.